हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू माय वीडियो ऑन गिम्प शॉप ट्यूटोरियल पार्ट वन। द बेसिक आइडिया बिहाइंड दिस पर्टिकुलर वीडियो इज टू प्रोवाइड फॉर द बिगिनर्स द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ हाउ टू लॉन्च द एप्लीकेशन, अंडरस्टैंडिंग द मेन्यूज व्हाट आर अवेलेबल इन द एप्लीकेशन सॉफ्टवेयर, एंड देन हाउ टू स्टार्ट नेविगेशन between the windows within the application software. I have installed the latest version of GIMP Shop version 2.8. Having installed the software, I can launch it from the start applications. I can go to start and then select programs, and then I can select GIMP Shop, select this, or simply I can right click this and select open. Initially when it starts, it takes some time. It also depends on what additional brushes, gradients, etc. we have put in our folders. Otherwise, a newly installed software should start immediately. It starts reading all the data, the scripts, the brushes, etc. from the software. Now, in the version 2.8, we have a single window what we have with us. In fact, when you launch it, it won't be like this. Basically, what you see here will be available in three separate windows, but I have added them together to get the single window. This is the one of the advantage in the new version 2.8. Otherwise, by default, it will be something like this. Okay. When you launch it, you will have three different sections. On the left side, you have something called Toolbox. And then you have in the middle the work area, and then you have something called the dockable windows on the right side. Okay, but to make it more easy for working, we can always put them together. So I can select windows and then put them into single window mode. Okay, but some people may find it more easier if it is in separate windows, so we can adjust it according to the individual requirements. Now when you look at this particular section here, the entire work area is divided into three sections. On the left side, you have got the toolbox, what you saw just before. Then we have the various dialog docs, what you are able to see on the right side, and one which you see on the top, which is basically a menu bar. Okay. Now, GIMP is fairly menu-driven kind of a software. We can start working straight away from the menus, from the menu bar, and it's having drop-down menus depending on what is the activity you would like to do. We can select the particular section of the menu and start activating it. And most of them, or rather I would be not very sure, most of them can also be launched through hotkeys simply by selecting the particular hotkey from the keyboard. Okay. Now, basically, most of the time we'll be working to start to create a file, then we'll be working on the images, maybe we'll be adding certain effects through filters. Okay. So as you start working on a particular project, we'll see how to use them. But let's first try to understand the one which is here, what is called toolbox. The toolbox, standard toolbox, has basically tools what you use for working on the design. Obviously, the most important would be the brush, okay, and then the pencil part of it, and then you have eraser here, and most of the, all of them have got their individual dialogs. For instance, I want to have my own controls when I'm working using the brush. I simply select the brush, but effectively it is also opening a dialog below so that I can start adjusting the brush according to my requirements. For instance, I'll be working on the gradients, then I'll be selecting this, then accordingly you have a dialog opening up here. So as you start working, you can select the individual, you know, the parameters according to our design requirement. Now coming back to the menu part, to create a new file, suppose let's assume basically what for I'm going to use GIMP for. GIMP can be used for creating basically, let's say, an image, a fresh, you know, painting I would like to do from scratch. Okay, that could be one part. Already I have an image, but I would like to rework on this. Maybe I want to adjust the color of it, or I want to adjust the brightness of it, or I want to crop it, or I want to write a text on the existing image, or I would like to add some special effects on the basically the image what I have. Or sometimes I may have to combine two images to get the composite image. Okay, so there is an endless options or requirements what one would be looking for, and most of these requirements what otherwise we have as a designer, as an amateur, as a professional, we have all these requirements taken care by GIMP. Okay. One advantage with the GIMP would be it is an open source software, so we can download it and then use it according to our requirement. At the same time, there is a wide, you know, the big community around the net where you can get a lot of information, a lot of assistance when you are stuck somewhere, and also you can download a lot of usable, you know, the parameters what you require. For instance, when you load the standard GIMP software, it will be coming with a ready to use kind of brushes. For example, these are the standard brushes which are otherwise provided already by GIMP. Okay, but I can always get some new brushes according to my requirements from wide sources from the internet. For instance, what you see here, a cloud brush, okay, ready to draw a cloud effect on my image. Okay, I simply can use this particular brush, but I have downloaded from the internet. Okay, likewise, there are something like birds, what you can see here, these are all not provided in the standard software, but you can always download from the various sources. But once you download where to put them and where to activate, we can see in the next tutorials. But this is something which is very flexible and something which I can always go to any extent to get my required brushes. Okay, one aspect of brush design is I can also create my own brush, okay, so which I want to reuse it again and again. So that's the advantage of working on the brush part of it. Now basically, when you're working on the image, as I said before, it could be a fresh design from scratch, or it could be working on an image, or it could be constructing a sort of an image using multiple layers. Okay, so depending on the work, we still have to, you know, start working by creating the file. If I'm bringing the image, of course the image will come straight away by drag and then start working on this. But let's try to understand the file control. Select the file, and then I'm going to create a new file, the workable file. So select new. Now every image I'm going to work will have a size to it which is measured in terms of pixels. Okay, it has a width of 640 pixels and height of 400. This is the default size what you get when you start. Okay, but you can always select a particular required image size in pixels by using one of these templates, which can be the standard templates according to the web designs, etc. For instance, if I'm designing a cover page for Facebook group, then suddenly I would like to work on 800 by maybe 215. That is the size which is, you know, something which you can fit very easily on the Facebook cover page. Okay, but at the moment, let me select the default one. Let's select OK. Then we have the working area in front of us. Okay. Now every image as a basic design has got two part of it. One is the background and another is the foreground. Okay. Now at this moment, the color of the background is white. Okay, and anything I'm going to write or draw on this will be a foreground color. Okay. Now the color adjustment can be done by selecting this particular section. What you see here, the one which is seen here is black, it is basically the foreground, okay, and one you see on the black white, it is basically the foreground, the background. Okay, now to select the particular color, I can always click them, then I have a color, you know, dialog in front of us. Now I can select the particular required color by adjusting the the parameters what we use, or you can even use the various color codes, HTML color codes what are available in the web. I can simply enter the code over here, and then system will give me the required color, and I can always activate. Okay. Now coming back to the background color, this is something which I can always adjust by selecting this, and then again select the required color. As a simple exercise, I want to fill up the background color with a particular design, with a particular color. So let me select, let's say for instance, the green color, and then I'll say fill it up. So select the fill tool and then fill it up. Okay, I'm sorry, I filled it with the foreground color, so let me do Control Z. Okay, now basically I want to, let's say, fill up with this particular color. So obviously it is something which I'm putting on the background, so obviously it has to be a foreground color. So I want to select this particular color, let's assume this. So I'm selecting the foreground color and then select the fill up and then draw this. That means it is going to be something which I have put on the basic color. Okay. Now, instead of this, I want to work on the gradient part. That means my image should have two colors in the form of a gradient. So I can always select the gradient tab. So obviously it won't be in single color, but it will be back foreground to background. A sort of gradient will be created. Simply I can add this particular gradient by drawing from top to bottom. Then I have a gradient over here. So basically, it's something which I can start working. When you start working, we can add up the colors to the background and the foreground by using the brush and the fill button, bucket fill button or gradient. We also can sometimes work with the standard, what you call templates, what we have with us. Okay. Now, I'm going to explain something more on the filter side and also on the layer side as the introduction part in this particular video. Now, every image what we have in front of us is having a single layer or having multiple layers. At this moment, we have one single layer, but when you start working, we might be working with various images on the top of this, so they all become stackable images. Okay, each stack is called as a layer, and each layer has its own properties. Okay, one single image, what I see as the end result, could be the result of n number of layers which have been put together or which have been worked independently. Okay, filters is one particular section here which I can use it for adding special effects to my image. For instance, I would like to add some blur to some particular section, or I want to add some kind of light and shadow effect to my images. Okay, or when I'm working on, let's say, text, you know, I want to add some kind of a special design to that. I can add alpha to the logo. So it's very comprehensive in terms of meeting basically most of our requirements. So in this part, first part one, I have basically tried to explain you what are the three important sections in the navigation. We have the toolbox, we have the various, you know, the dockable add-ons here which can use it for quickly doing the required thing, and most important of course will be the working area, and one which you see on the top is called the menu bar. Okay, in the next section, in the video part 2, we'll see how to start creating paint designs initially by adding our own gradients or drawing some simple designs by using brushes, okay, or using some kind of templates, etc. Thank you for watching this.